Well, thank you, Dave, and good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming out tonight. We've got a very exciting and relevant topic to consider, haven't we? Brexit and the Bible, what next? Indeed, we've seen some momentous events taking place in this country of late, have we not? We've seen that vote on the 23rd of June, where 51.9% of the British public voted to come away from the European Union. We've seen David Cameron, the Prime Minister, resign. We've got a new Prime Minister establishing her cabinet today. We've seen the world in shock. Words like earthquake were being used on the media. But to Christadelphians, who I'm here to represent this evening, it's not actually come as a major shock to us. And so what this first talk is about trying to show you that actually these events that we are actually witnessing as we live our lives may already have been predetermined in the pages of scripture. Now that might sound a bit crazy, a bit strange, but bear with us. Wait till the end of the second talk and then come talk to me afterwards, because I think there is some compelling evidence that suggests that this is the case. Now, against all the odds, Britain has come away from the EU, and the process has started, hasn't it, to Brexit from the EU. And as I say, Christadelphians were not massively surprised. It is quite distressing for many people. But for us as Christadelphians, when we open our Bibles, we find that God is in control. That's the message of the Bible. So we have a passage here from Daniel chapter 4. The Most High, that's God, ruleth in the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever he will, and setteth up over it the basest of men. And in the New Testament too, in Romans chapter 13, we read, there is no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. So man, with his democracy, with his humanism, he thinks he's in control of his destiny. But the Bible says no. The Bible says, in fact, unbeknown to mankind, God is actually in control. That's quite a statement, isn't it? And as I say, Christadelphians, we weren't surprised, because we believe these things and we believe they're indicated in the scriptures of truth. These are Christadelphian publications going way back in time to Elpis Israel, written by the founder of the Christadelphian community, John Thomas, in 1848. And various other ones we could have put more on. All of these, in these documents, these Christadelphians were expecting Britain to separate, to be separate from Europe. Now, obviously, Britain entered into Europe, which puzzled a lot of Christadelphians in the 70s. But since that time, still, Christadelphians have held to this view that, you know what? We believe the Bible. We believe that ultimately, before Jesus Christ returns to the earth, Britain is going to be separate. So here's some documents written by Christadelphians. There's some milestones there from 1981. The time will come when the European system will, the top one, we do not know how it will happen. Britain will separate from Europe. This one here in 1990, Britain's exit from Europe is inevitable. And here from 2007, we do not know what circumstances will cause Britain to change her current direction and eventually come out of Europe, but it is clear that she must do so. So I just mentioned that. That doesn't prove anything, but it just mentioned that because it's not like we're stood here in hindsight saying, ah, well, there you go. We did have, as a community, members of our community who looked at their Bibles and came to these conclusions before Brexit took place. Now, Dave read for us Ezekiel chapter 38. If you don't have a Bible, it's okay, because I'm going to read some of the passages and we're going to put a lot of it up on the screen. But I don't know if you noticed that at the end of Ezekiel chapter 38, which is quite a complicated prophecy, it mentions a lot of ancient names, a lot of strange things. It talks about this great group of nations that come down and attack Israel from the north. And we're told at the very end, in verse 23, that it is at this time that God will magnify himself and sanctify himself. And we read there that I will be known, says God, in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. So as Christadelphians, we believe the Bible. We believe this is a prophecy of the future at the time when Jesus Christ will return to the earth. And it's going to be my job this evening a little bit to unpick some of the information in this prophecy and hopefully show you how relevant it is to our times. So talking of relevance, I don't know if you've got it open in front of you, but you might notice a couple of things. In verse 8 we read, "After many days thou," the Jews, "shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come back into the land that is brought back from the sword and is gathered out of many people. And this is a great army that comes against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them." Now, what that's telling us is that this prophecy is about a time when the Jews have been regathered to their land, a time called the latter days, and they're there in their land dwelling safely after a time of dispersion. And we've witnessed in recent years, in 1948, the restoration, as it were, of the Jewish nation. We've seen them come back after being scattered, actually, by the Romans around AD 70 throughout the known world. And they've been the wandering Jew, haven't they, all over the place. But the Bible has said they're going to come back. And this is one of those prophecies that indicates that. Look there in verse 12, that this army comes to take a spoil and to take a prey. And it's going to turn its hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited and upon the people that are gathered out of the nations, which have gotten cattle and goods and dwell in the midst of the land. Now this proves, doesn't it, the Bible is quite relevant. It said the Jews are going to come back, and as we say, that's happened. But not only that, this prophecy is about controversy. Specifically, we are told in the chapter, against the mountains of Israel. And of course, in the mountainous regions of Israel at the moment, we have the West Bank, probably the most controversial area of the world today. And finally, we just read there in verse 12 that this is a time when Israel, the people of Israel, are wealthy. And I don't know if you know, but they've recently found a lot of amazing gas finds just off of Israel. And in that region, Israel is set to become extremely, extremely rich. So it's very relevant prophecy for our time. Israel has been regathered, and the Bible says, "Shortly, therefore, these events of Ezekiel 38 will unfold. And at the end of that time, God is going to become known to the nations of the world." And we believe, and hopefully show you later, that is a reference to the Lord Jesus Christ being revealed to mankind. Now, in and amongst this chapter, I hope you're still with me, but in and amongst this chapter, there's some really interesting details. And one of those details is mentioned in verse 13, which we've put on the screen, because we have a block of nations in the first few verses, which are the invading force, but there is another set of nations which seems to challenge that invading force. And these nations are known as Sheba and Dedan and all the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof. And this group of nations say unto the invading force, "Hast thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey, to carry away silver and gold, to take away cattle and goods, to take away a great spoil?" Now, I mentioned to you that the Christadelphians in those pamphlets that I showed you, in those publications, had predicted that Britain would be separate from Europe. And the reason for that is that these scholars have identified Tarshish with the British power. And so we will find, and I'll show you hopefully later, that the European powers, we're told, are the ones who are invading Israel. But the Tarshish power here, with Sheba and Dedan, and we'll look at those later, they're the ones that are not with the invading force. They're the ones that are separate, and they are challenging the invader. So my job, the first job for this evening's first talk, is to very much look at this subject of Tarshish. Is it reasonable to believe that this ancient name is in fact a name of Britain that we use today? And the only way we can really appreciate that, because there isn't kind of a verse in the Bible that says Britain is Tarshish, full stop, because that would be nice, because then I could sit down. So it's not as simple as that. It's an ancient name, and even in history and archaeology, because this stretches back pre-history, unfortunately, we don't, again, have a clear archaeological evidence that says Tarshish is Britain. But what we do have, scripturally, is a number of references to Tarshish. And from these references, we can gain clues that help us to identify this nation and who it might be. Now, there's 24 verses which contain the word Tarshish. You'll be pleased to know we're not going to go through all of them. They can be generally grouped into these areas. So there's historical references to an actual place called Tarshish in the Bible. It starts with some ancient names, an ancient man who lived, and then in the time of the kings, it seems that there's a place that's been established called Tarshish. And then in the time of Ezekiel, around 600 BC, that the prophecy that we read, it's mentioned in Ezekiel's time, Tarshish is. And they're all historical. They're all kind of written in a way that you'd say, and so-and-so went to Tarshish. So it seems like it definitely was a real place and known to the audiences of the scriptures when they were first written. The second batch of references to Tarshish are where it's mentioned in prophetical language. So it's saying, in the latter days, like this in Ezekiel 38, these people of Tarshish, with their young lions, they're going to do X, Y, and Z. So it's a prophecy about something that would be in the future. We get prophecies of this Tarshish power in relation to Tyre and the Phoenician power in Lebanon. I'll look at that in later. In the latter days, like in Ezekiel 38. And also, we hope to show you, particularly in our second talk, if we get time, some passages which show us, amazingly, that this nation of Tarshish will indeed be part of the coming kingdom of Christ as subjects in that day. So this is quite an interesting subject, a broad subject. So I hope you're going to bear with me as we're going to try and pick up some clues which we'll take out of some of these pools of passages. And as I say, I believe that they do all eventually point us to the fact that when we read of Tarshish, we in our Bibles, we are indeed reading of the ancient name of the British Isles. So, clue number one is that Tarshish was a descendant of Japheth. We are not going to turn to this passage. I'm going to just give you an overview, a sketch. There's a recording. You can look these up later if you fancied it. It's in Genesis chapter 10. We read that Noah, after the flood, he had three sons. One of them was called Japheth, one of them called Ham, one of them called Shem, and that the Bible indicates that these descendants spread out loosely in the way that we've mentioned. Well, in fact, it's Josephus that mentions they spread out in this way. And we read of Tarshish and as being the son of Japheth. So as the first clue as to who Tarshish is, we suggest we wouldn't find Tarshish over in Japan. We won't probably find Tarshish down in Africa. It's reasonable to say this is an indication from Genesis 10, the sons of Japheth emigrated into Europe. So it's going to be a Western European power, most probably. That's clue number one. Clue number two is that when we come to fast forward in time, around to the time of the kings of Israel, around 900, 800 BC, we read a lot about the ships of Tarshish. You've probably heard that term if you read your Bible, the ships of Tarshish. So what we find is that the Tarshish power is often associated with maritime travel and trade. And so there's a ton of references there in relation to that. They're particularly linked to helping Solomon generate great wealth in 2 Chronicles chapter 9, because he does a deal with the ships of Tarshish and a king from Lebanon, from the Phoenicians, called Hiram in Tyre. And he does this three-way deal, and we're told in the Bible in Chronicles that this made Solomon incredibly wealthy, one of the wealthiest kings of the time. So at the heart of trade and commerce, there was Tarshish right back in those days. And as I say, this is, if you do get time, look up 2 Chronicles 9, because it tells us that this trade deal, they went to Tarshish at some point with Solomon, and they also brought back peacocks and African produce. So it seems this trade deal, whatever it was, we're not told specifically how it worked, but this trade deal with the Phoenicians of Tyre up to the north of Israel and Solomon, who had a port to the south in Ezion-Geber, this trade deal allowed them to accumulate great wealth. It took them 3 years each trade trip. And it's very interesting that Herodotus records that the Phoenicians did sail all the way around Africa, and it took them 3 years to do that. So we're not told exactly, but it would seem that Tarshish, because they went to Tarshish on this trading route, it does seem they had some trade in the east on this eastern side. Some Bible scholars have suggested that there is an eastern Tarshish. I'm not so sure we have to follow that conclusion. I think that Tarshish could be anywhere around this trade route. And I think what they did was that in the north, in Lebanon, they didn't have access to the Red Sea and India in this way. But Solomon did from his southern port. So they did this deal so that they could do a one massive three-year trip collecting goods, trading, and then bring all the wealth back, ship it across land, share it out, and then go all the way back round again, another three-year trip, and do that again. It doesn't take 3 years to get from Ezion-Geber to India and back again. But as I say, there is historical evidence from Herodotus to say it took 3 years to get all the way around Africa. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that there was this great trade that Tarshish did in the west, it seems, and in the east. Here's another clue. Clue number four. And this one's quite easy, you'll be pleased to know. They're not all as complicated as that other one. In the book of Jonah, again, we're still in the time of kings. We find that Jonah, he's asked to go and preach to the Ninevites, and he doesn't want to do so. So what he says is, I'm going to flee from the presence of God. And so he says there, we read in Jonah chapter 1, Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa, and he found a ship going to Tarshish. So Jonah wants to run away as fast as he can from the presence of God, which I think he associated with the temple in Jerusalem at that time. Now, Joppa is on the western side, it's modern-day Jaffa, of Israel, on the Mediterranean coast. So if he wanted to get as far away as quickly as possible, the furthest place he knew about was a place called Tarshish. He wants to get there quickly because he's fleeing. It indicates, doesn't it, that wherever Tarshish is, it's to the west. It's not to the east, it's to the west. It also indicates it's not somewhere nearby, doesn't it? Because he wants to flee far away. Now, I just want to bring in another little clue here from archaeology. I find this quite amazing. So around the time of Ezekiel, there was a king in Assyria called Esarhaddon. And he's a very proud king, and he wrote a lot of tablets. And on one of these tablets, this is what he says. All the kings from the lands surrounded by sea, from the country Ladanana, or Cyprus, and Laman, the Ionian Islands, which are off of Greece, as far as Tarshish, bowed to my feet. Now, what that indicates is, firstly, that Tarshish was in the west, because his mind, you see, is going from where? From Cyprus to the islands of Greece to somewhere called Tarshish. So it seems that Tarshish was the most westerly place that he could think of. And he's boasting, they all fell to my feet. But it also tells us, doesn't it? Here is a first-hand account of someone who lived at the time of Ezekiel. It also tells us that wherever Tarshish was, it was known to be an island, which obviously discounts a few places. And Esarhaddon would know, wouldn't he? Because he lived at that time. The fifth clue. There's eight, so bear with me. The fifth clue is that Tarshish was a source of amazing metals. Now, if you have got your Bibles, just flick over to Ezekiel chapter 27. Now, I've already mentioned the great King Hiram of the Phoenicians who lived in Tyre at the time of Solomon and David. And at the time of Solomon and David, he actually helped to build a temple to the God of Israel in Jerusalem. But as time went on, his descendants forgot the God of Israel. And so the Bible says that the prophets of Israel, they proclaimed a judgment against the power of the Phoenicians, against the people of Tyre. And so Ezekiel 27 is one of these prophecies. For example, it says in verse 1, "The word of the Lord came again unto me, Ezekiel, saying, Now thou son of man, take up a lamentation for Tyrus." And it goes on to berate Tyre. And in verses 5 through to 7, we get the greatness of Tyre's ships mentioned. In verses 8 to 11, we read of the wonder of the personnel of Tyre. In verses 12 to 25, we read of the traders that came to Tyre with their various wares to make money. And then in verses 26 to 36, we read of how all that grandeur would actually come to an end. Now, we're interested in verses 12 to 25 of the traders that came to Tyre, to that great Phoenician power, where they traded all these goods, because we get mentioned in verse 12 that Tarshish was there. It says, "Tarshish was thy merchant by reason of the multitude of all kind of riches. With silver, iron, tin, and lead, they traded in thy fairs." Now, why that's interesting is because when actually you read on, you find all these other nations and what they brought. And I think it's reasonable to assume that where these other nations bringing this, bringing these goods to Tyre, it's reasonable to assume that these goods were native to the area that those nations came from. So, for example, in verse 21, from Arabia and Kedar, they brought lambs, rams, and goats. So these were lambs, rams, and goats that were brought up in Arabia and Kedar and moved over to Tyre to make money from. If that is right, then what that means is that wherever Tarshish is, and remember, we're going to hopefully come to it later. We're trying to show the clues, and we're going to eventually look at the evidence, as it were, that Britain fits these clues. That Tarshish here, wherever Tarshish is, it has native to it silver, iron, tin, and lead. Now, they're quite rare to find in one place altogether. Particularly rare is to find tin in the ancient world. So that's a very interesting identifier for us to consider in a few moments. Bit of extra archaeological evidence here. And this is the oldest, I believe, non-biblical reference to the Jewish temple ever discovered. It's on a potsherd. It's actually a receipt. So next time you're in Tesco and they give you a receipt, be thankful you're not putting that in your pocket anymore. We read on this receipt, "Pursuant to the order to you of Ashayahu the king, to give by the hand of Zechariah silver of Tarshish to the house or temple of Yahweh 3 shekels. Now, it's a receipt. It's saying basically that this guy has to pay someone some money. But interestingly, look, it says that it's going to be specifically the silver of Tarshish which is to be paid. So this is an extra biblical source, which is, again, backing up what the Bible says, that Tarshish was famous for its metals. 3 quick ones more. Another prophecy about Tyre is found in Isaiah chapter 23. Perhaps we can flick over to Isaiah 23. I know I'm getting you to work. Don't worry, the second talk will not require so much flicking around in your Bibles. And so I hope you can bear with me while we do this. Now in Isaiah chapter 23, we get another prophecy from a prophet of Israel, Isaiah, against Tyre. And we get connected very quickly, the ships of Tarshish, which are wrapped up with Tyre. In verse 1, "The burden of Tyre, howl ye ships of Tarshish, for it is laid waste." And so we get the idea that this is a time when Tyre, there's a prophecy from Isaiah, that Tyre is going to be laid waste. And who is going to be mourning? Why, but the trading power of the day, the ships of Tarshish, which have come with their wares. And it's interesting to note that Nebuchadnezzar, around 570 BC, he came and kind of destroyed Tyre. It kind of revived a little bit, and then Alexander the Great came in around 332 BC. So this prophecy is all about, we would suggest, one or other of those great attacks against Tyre. But interestingly, in verse 6, we are told that the people of Tyre and the power and influence of Tyre would pass over to Tarshish. So whoever Tarshish is, according to the Bible, it will adopt and continue to kind of have the power at some point after this moment when Tyre fell, that power would pass to Tarshish. And interestingly, we're told there that when it passes over, it says her own feet shall carry her afar off to Sojourn. So wherever Tarshish is, it's a far away place from Lebanon in North Israel, from the place of Tyre, right at the top of your screen there. So they're all the kind of historical passages. I just want to look at two clues from the latter days. Now, we've already shown in Ezekiel chapter 38, if you flick back there for 2 seconds, we've already shown how relevant Ezekiel chapter 38 is for us in our day. We've mentioned how the Bible says that Ezekiel 38 is a prophecy of the latter days. And we've also mentioned that it's the latter days is when the time when the Jews would be regathered to their land. And here in the latter days, as we've mentioned, we have this invading force in the first few verses. We'll look at that briefly in a moment and in more detail in the second talk. And then finally, we have another set of nations, of which Tarshish is one, challenging the invading force. Now, I don't know if you noticed a very peculiar turn of phrase. It says, it's talking about political powers, Sheba, Dedan, and the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof. And you think that's a peculiar turn of phrase, isn't it? We've got all these political powers, and then suddenly we've got these lions mentioned. Now, I don't think this is talking about literal lions running around. The Bible uses figurative language frequently. And I think what we find when we consider this word in the Hebrew, when we consider this word in the Hebrew, will it go back? It's refusing. Oh, there we go. I've got my slides mixed up. Bear with me. I knew something would go wrong. It was going too well, so bear with me. We read of the young lions. Now, if you've got your Bible open, just flick to Ezekiel 19, because we get in Ezekiel 19 a picture of what this might mean, the young lions. So Ezekiel chapter 19 is talking about Israel. I don't think the young lions of Tarshish are anything to do with Israel because they're from Tarshish. But what we read of in verse 1 is that this lamentation is going to come over the princes of Israel. And in verse 2, it says, "And say, what is thy mother? A lioness. She lay down among lions. She nourished her whelps among young lions. And she brought up one of her whelps. It became a young lion and it learned to catch the prey. It devoured men." And it goes on. But the point I'm trying to make, now this is talking about one of the kings, I think Zedekiah, of the ancient Israelites, and it's talking in symbolic language. But the point I'm trying to make is, look what the Bible's saying. It says, it's a growth of a male lion. It starts off as a whelp, but when it becomes independent of its mother, when it can catch its own prey, it becomes a young lion. So when we think about then the young lions of Tarshish, in the context of a political verse where it's talking about political powers, what we're being told is that the young lions are in fact political offspring which are able and independent. They can rend their own prey, so to speak. They're not part of the original pride anymore. They can go off and do their own thing. So whoever Tarshish is, we believe that we will find them a colonial power, as it were, at the time after the Jews have return to their land in the latter days. The final point we wish to make is that, again, in Ezekiel 38, we've read that they are merchants of Tarshish, trading, it seems, with Sheba and Dedan. Now, I'm not going to spend much time on this. It's not disputed amongst scholars where Sheba and Dedan is. There's some evidence on the screen there. It's in this area here, in the southern Gulf. And also Dedan, these are some graffiti inscriptions that you can find at Al-Ula, which mention that this is the ancient place called Dedan. I think that's quite funny, actually, that archaeologists have dug up graffiti. It's like me carving here, Matt was here, and someone digging it up and finding it useful. You know, 2,000 odd years later. But it helps us identify where those areas are. And so that's quite handy. So what we're being told is that in the latter days, after Israel has been regathered to their land, 1948 onwards, whoever Tarshish is, we will find them trading in the area of the Gulf. That's what we're being told. Fascinating stuff. So, just to recap, I hope everyone's still with me. We've got these eight clues, and we've whizzed through those. So the question is does Britain fit the bill? Is it reasonable to believe that Britain is Tarshish that we read of in our Bibles? So we're going to whiz through some of these. Is it, does it fit this clue, a descendant of Japheth? Well, clearly it's in that area, as we would expect. So we give that one a little tick. What about being an ancient maritime power trading in global markets? What evidence is there that the British power, the ancient British people, actually were quite nifty in terms of maritime prowess? Well, this is a boat in the Dover Museum. And fascinatingly, I believe it's the oldest boat ever to have been discovered. Found off of the coast I believe it's down, where was it? Hang on, Folkestone. That's right. No, it wasn't off the coast. They were digging a road between Dover and Folkestone. And the workers found this boat, and it was removed, and there it is in the museum. It's thought to be 3,000 years old. The oldest boat known to man was found in Britain. If that's not a sign of the maritime prowess of the ancient Britons, I don't know what might be. It's very rare to find boats of this kind. There's only 20 Bronze Age boats ever been found, and this is one of them. How about this one? They found another old shipwreck off of Salcombe near Devon. Again, thought to be around 900 BC. That's the cutting there when they found it in 2010. Did they trade with the Mediterranean nations? Is that reasonable to believe? What evidence is there? Well, it's very difficult. It's prehistory. But we have got some indications. So Britain's ancient connection to Carthage. 2,300-year-old coin reveals Mediterranean trade route dating back to the Iron Age, which is before the Bronze Age. So it's very, very, very old. It was found near the River Arnon, near Bristol. So we've got this amazing find here, which seems to indicate that Britain was indeed trading with Mediterranean nations in those days. What about this one? They dug up this skeleton just outside Stonehenge. They did some tests, and they found that actually, by looking at some of the minerals and stuff in the bones of this poor boy who died and was obviously buried, that he was from the Mediterranean. But even more remarkably, they did their tests and they found that he was about 3,500 years old. So that's Bronze Age, that's the time of Ezekiel. And so we have another indicator that peoples from the Mediterranean indeed were coming to Britain in the time of Ezekiel. I think that's absolutely fascinating. So it's hard from that time in history, but we do have indicators to suggest that Britain fits these two signs. Now, obviously, located to the west of Israel, spoiler alert, that obviously happens. We'll move on. That one fits as well. How about a source of silver, iron, tin, and lead? Now, this for me is one of the clinches, you know. I think individually you can pull apart some of these ideas, but collectively they stand together quite powerfully, and particularly having this one in the mix is strong. Because in Britain, the minerals for silver, iron, tin, and lead are all found. My wife thought I was a bit nuts when on holiday in Derbyshire I had spent a while in the Peak District Mining Museum taking photos of rocks. She thought I'd gone crazy. But here's some of them. And I thought that it was fascinating because it proved that these minerals are indeed in Britain. Now, it's true to say that some of them are also found in Spain. But as we'll see, I don't think we can say Tarshish is Spain because it doesn't fit some of the other clues, particularly that extra biblical clue which said from S.R. Haddon that Tarshish was an island power. Anyway, these minerals are all found in Britain. Now, is it reasonable to assume that they were indeed mined at the time of Ezekiel and processed and then brought to Tyre to sell? Well, just consider some of these things. So here's a Bronze Age hoard found intact in Essex in a field, okay? And again, they found loads of metal objects there. And the interesting thing is when they come and find tin, for example, here's a cauldron which was made of tin. It was made of bronze. Bronze requires tin and copper together to make it. So it needs to be smelted, right? Those minerals, those rocks, they need to have a process to go through. This particular one, this cauldron, you can see, obviously, there's quite a lot of manufacturing going on to produce that. It was found with 69 axes, 13 spearheads, 5 knives, 2 socketed gouges, and goes on. Loads of metal artifacts, and the experts dated it to 1270 BC and 1140 BC. So Bronze Age. How about this tin nugget from Cornwall, thought to be around 2000 BC when they dated it. But was this tin being transferred? There's not a lot of evidence. It's very difficult to find artifacts from this period of time going back. But I was interested to read recently of this thing, the Nebra Sky Disc. Now, they did their tests. It's 3,600 years old. This is UNESCO, the United Nations Education, Scientific and Cultural Organization. And it was ancient. It was found in Germany. Interestingly, by the way, they think they used it to map the stars back in the day, like and give a sense of the time and the seasons. But by the way, it was found that the tin used in this metal artifact was found to be from Cornwall. So interestingly, we've got an artifact 3,000 odd years old, and the tin used is from Britain, but it's not found in Britain. It's found across in Central Europe. It's not hard to therefore see that British tin was being traded in the ancient world. I'll just run through a couple more. There's another shipwreck there. Interestingly, in this one, they found absolutely loads of tin nuggets or ingots, as some people pronounce it, which shows that when that boat sank with all the 44 ingots on it, it was probably trading them, wasn't it? Why do you travel around with 44 tin ingots in your Bronze Age vessel? Well, you travel around because you're traveling to the continent to trade them. Here's another one in Devon, where they found loads of ingots as well. Again, these are all Bronze Age. These are all the time of Ezekiel. And these were covered in the British Archaeology magazine. It says there, they lay on the seabed for over 3,000 years, hundreds of metal objects from Moresand, Devon and Langdon Bay, Kent, now promise unique insights into the world of Bronze Age Europe. And I'm not going to go through the whole article, but you can see how much they found by just looking at some of the pictures there from that time. This is a commerce. This is evidence of trade. This is evidence of industry. Interestingly, they found this weird axe thing. And it says there, this enigmatic piece of bronze from Moresand, Salcombe, is of key significance, of mysterious function. It is of a type known only from Sicily, where it would have been made at the same date as the other bronze and gold items from the site. It is the only sound evidence for a connection between Central Mediterranean and Northwest Europe in the Bronze Age. Well, I don't think it's the only one, but that's just my opinion. But there we go, we do have these connections. Now, just one other point. When we come to the far east, we have some evidence that tin was not mined and produced in the east. This is the periplus of the Ethrian Sea. Periplus is, if you are a kind of a trading merchant back in the day, it's basically a list of the ports. So if you find a port over here that needs something, but is selling something else cheap, and a port over the other side which needs the thing that port is selling cheap, then you can start a little trade route and make yourself a lot of money. So the periplus is the shipmaster's kind of guide to noting down what's needed and what isn't needed by different ports. Very interesting. 30 AD, so you're 600 odd, 700 years off from Ezekiel. But fascinatingly, tin is only mentioned as an import, never as an export. So I think it's mentioned in relation to Egypt, but in Egypt there was no minerals of tin there. So wherever the tin came from in the ancient world, it did not come from the east. It came from somewhere else, somewhere in the west. And we're told by the ancient historians where the tin came from. It's a bit enigmatic, but bear with me on this one. The next talk is a lot lighter, so bear with me. But I really want to show you this because it is exciting. So this is the father of history. This is Herodotus. This is the guy who really was the first historian. 440 BC, a few hundred years off from Ezekiel. And this is what he says. He says, "Of that part of Europe nearest to the west, I am not able to speak with decision. I by no means believe that the barbarians give the name of Eridanus to a river which empties itself into the northern sea, whence, as it is said, our amber comes." And this is the point. "Neither am I better acquainted with the islands called the Cassiterides, from which we are said to have our tin. It is nevertheless certain that both our tin and our amber are brought from these extreme regions." Now, Herodotus travelled all around the ancient world, okay? Really interesting guy, and he wrote it all down in his books, The Histories of Herodotus. And what he says is that it's really strange. You know, it must have been strange to him. He's a Greek, right? The Greeks loved their bronze, and they needed tin to make all their bronze stuff. But he did not know where this tin came from. He'd heard this rumour that it came from the west, from these islands called the Islands of Tin, the Cassiterides. And he says, "I've got no doubt, I'm certain that they come from there. It's just I've never been there. It's a bit mysterious." Now, this is a map of, or in a book, basically, of how when you read Herodotus' history, this is what he was aware of. He was fully aware of Spain, of Iberia. He was fully aware of Turkey and the areas of the Middle East. But he says, no, the tin didn't come from all them. It came from somewhere, you know, far away in the west, this group of islands called the Cassiterides, an extreme region. So Britain seems to fit the bill, doesn't it? How about this one? When Julius Caesar came to Britain, he mentioned that tin was in production in Britain way back, you know, where 40 BC. Diodorus, around 8 BC, he says, "Now we shall speak something concerning the tin that is dug and gotten in Britain," he's talking about. "They that inhabit the British promontory of Belirium, by reason of their converse with the merchants, are more civilized and courteous to strangers than the rest. These are the people that make the tin, which with a great deal of care and labour they dig out of the ground," and that being rocky, and it goes on. The point is, tin was in production and clearly recorded by the ancient historians. One final passage. If you fell asleep for all that, fine, but just listen to this one, because this one explains the mystery as to why nobody really understood where this tin was coming from. This is Strabo. "The Cassiterides are 10 in number and lie near each other in the ocean. Of the metals, they have tin and lead. Formerly, the Phoenicians alone from Gades engrossed this market, hiding the navigation from all others. When the Romans followed a certain shipmaster that they might discover the market, the jealous shipmaster willfully stranded his vessel on a shoal, misleading those who were tracking him to the same destruction. Escaping from the shipwreck by the means of a fragment of the ship, he was indemnified for his losses out of the public treasury." You see why it was a mystery to Herodotus. These Phoenicians, they wanted it all for themselves. Okay, they were clever people. And so they hid it from everybody else. So, yes, source of silver, iron, tin, and lead. Did the British power take over from the ancient Phoenicians? Well, this is a map of the British Empire. Whatever you think of the British Empire, they did do a great deal of trade. And they did trade in the east as well as the west. So I think you can assert that the prophecy in Isaiah that said that the Tarshish power, so the Tyrian power, would pass over to Tyre. The Tyrian power would pass over to Tarshish can be said to be fulfilled by the British. How about now when we get into the latter days? This is our time, okay, after Israel has been regathered. So is the British power a colonial power having independent political offspring? And of course the answer is yes, because the ancient, the British Empire has disintegrated, hasn't it? And the nations of the British Empire, many still have the Queen as their head, but they are, in fact, most of them, independent states. They do what they want, but they give a nod to Her Majesty the Queen. And interestingly, post-Brexit, it is the young lions, if we can call them that, of the Commonwealth, which are all scrambling to get a deal with Britain. And I understand in the Cabinet they've just kind of set up a whole department to help begin trade, and I'm sure the Commonwealth nations will be right there. New Zealand wants to help, which is very nice of them, I'm sure. So I think we can indeed say that Britain is a colonial power having independent offspring. The merchants of Tarshish and the young lions are at work in the latter days, in our days today. How about a trading power in the Gulf? Well, there's lots of movements afoot if you're in business. If you want to go and trade in the Gulf, the British government want you to go over there and do business. I'm not going to go through the facts. There's huge amounts of business being done with the Gulf. Just this year, you know, lots of business being done. Here's an interesting article just from after Brexit. Brexit expected to boost Britain's ties with the Gulf Cooperation Council. You know, people think the Bible's an irrelevant book. Isn't this amazing? We look at our Bibles and then we look at the news and we see some of these things, it seems, coming to pass before our eyes. It's fascinating. We see here, Brexit UK may be able to trade faster with the Gulf Cooperation Council. And are Britain in that area ready? Are they there? Could they challenge an invading force? Well, yes, they are. This is the Navy has actually got a mission on their website where they basically tour the Gulf and keep the Gulf safe. It's called Operation Kipian. Fascinatingly, on the website there, ensuring the safe flow of trade and oil in the area. Art thou come to take a spoil? You know, don't touch our trade routes. It seems that is a clear indicator. And, you know, they're taking a lead in that area. So, trading power in the Gulf in the latter days, I think we can also give that a tick. So, descendant of Japheth, yes. Maritime power, yes. Traded in global markets, yes. Located to the west, yes. Source of silver, iron, tin and lead, yes. Takes over from Tyre, yes. Colonial power, yes. Trading power in the Gulf, yes. No other nation, I would suggest to you, fits the bill of what the Bible says, particularly in relation to the latter days, than the British power. The question is, if Britain isn't Tarshish, if you're a Bible believer, if Britain isn't Tarshish, then who is? So we've identified, tentatively, we would suggest, very strongly, in fact, not tentatively, that Britain is Tarshish. Now, before I sit down, I just would beg 5 minutes of your time to show you why that is significant. And the answer to why it's significant is, again, wrapped up in Ezekiel chapter 38. Now, I've mentioned one block of nations who are trading, who challenge the invading force in the latter days that come against Israel. But towards the end of this talk and into the second talk, we want to look at the invading nations, because this is a snapshot of the world and the world's superpowers before the Lord Jesus Christ returns. So it's massively relevant to us who are living in this time period. Now, this invading force is headed up, we read in verse 2, by this chap called Gog. Now, with Gog, we're told that Gog in verse 2 comes from the land of Magog. And these are all ancient names of peoples that are not familiar with us. So we do have to dig back. So Josephus tells us that Magog was this group of people that the Greeks called Scythians. And so we have to find out where the Scythians came from. And so we go back to Herodotus, and Herodotus tells us that the territory of the Scythians was basically 8 rivers came through the territory of the Scythians. To make life easier, I've just drawn the 2 extreme ones on a map. So according to the ancient historians, and linking that with the Bible then, the land of Magog was the Scythian area between these 2 rivers, the modern river Danube and the river Don. Also, in this group of nations, we read in verse 6 another one called Gomer. and all his bands in verse 6. Gomer is with Gog, who is from Magog. Who is Gomer? Now, Gomer is the ancient name given to the Greeks called the Galatians or the Gomerites. We read that this was the ancient name of the Gauls. If you were like me growing up, you may have read Asterix the Gaul. And was Asterix the Gaul English? No, he was French. So the Gauls became the Franks, the French. And so the area of Gomer is this area here. These are the peoples. This is where the peoples of Gomer and Magog eventually end up in history. So the invading force, which is politically and military unified, consists of these peoples from the EU, and they come down, the Bible says, against Israel. And so we'd expect them to unify. So what have we seen? Well, after the war, we saw the European project began. Since that time, various nations joined this European power block, and it continued to grow, didn't it, down through time. In 1973, Britain joined the then-known EEC. Some of us may have lived through this. 1975 looks a bit familiar to me, but it's not the latest. The latest one. This was the vote that took place under Ted Heath or Edward Heath in 1975. But each as the years rolled on, the powers of Europe continued to integrate politically. In recent times, military armies have been suggested. Borders have been taken down. Laws are made. This gave the rise in this country, didn't it, to the UKIP party. As I say, we're not political, but I just make the point that this kind of idea of Britain rebelling really was seeded by this chap, Nigel Farage, and he's talking about European integration. He said he doesn't want any of that, and if an idea is indeed sensible, it will eventually become just part of the accepted wisdom. So he said that in 2009, campaigning against it. That led, didn't it, to the Conservatives putting it in their manifesto. And of course, that led to the June 23rd Brexit vote, which shook the world. And of course, the European leaders are now saying, well, we'll see you later. See you later, Britain. So as these powers here of Gomer and Magog continue to integrate, the British power is not part of them. And that's why many of the Christadelphians that I showed you at the beginning, who were writing about expecting Brexit to take place, that's why they'd come to that conclusion. Because in Ezekiel 38, just before Jesus returns, we have an invading force, a group of nations, unified militarily, politically and economically, coming down, consisting of the EU nations. And we have a very separate response from the merchants of Tarshish, who have a different political agenda in that day, and they challenge that invasion. Now, obviously, you've come to a talk which asks the question, what next? I hope we've laid some foundations there, because in our second talk, we're going to look at how relevant and exciting these events are, particularly for us Christadelphians, because they do indeed speak to us of the soon return of the Lord Jesus Christ and a future coming kingdom of God. So I hope you enjoy your coffee. I'm going to Brexit off of the platform now. Thank you.